Okay, now let's get into block shear, the design equations associated with the block shear limit state. If you're talking about tension members by themselves, you're generally talking about the two limit states of rupture and yielding. Block shear is often associated with it because it's the connection, the member at the connection, in tension. So it's usually associated with that, although we're gonna go to a different chapter, chapter J. So if you're looking at your manual, if you go back to the spec, chapter J, let's see. We're talking about chapter J is all about connections, the design of connections. And we're going to specifically go, let's see, the first part is about, well, J2 is about welds, and then we get into bolts. And a bolt, and the bolts themselves. And then we're in J4, which is affected elements of members and the connecting element. So this section applies to elements of members at connections and connecting elements such as plates, gusset plates, angles, and brackets. J4 is in, it's page, let's see. 16.1-137. J4.1 is talking about elements in tension only. And that is actually, if we go look at it, right. Here we are at J4. And we have elements in tension. You'll see you have tension yielding and tension rupture, which are similar, the exact equations that you have in chapter D. And then elements in shear, this would be for like a shear tab connection, like where you're connecting a beam to a column. Which generally, you have vertical reactions, shear. And finally, we have block shear, which is what we're going to talk about. So J4.1, like I said, they have two limit states, yielding and rupture. Now we've moved to Rn, but it's right like Pn. Phi FYAG, and your phi is equal to 0.9. This is the design tensile strength of an element at a connection. And then rupture, VRN is V F U A G with a fee of 0.75. That should be familiar because that's the same stuff that's back in chapter D. Those are the exact same equations. All right, it even says, I wrote AG, it's supposed to be AE. Sorry. It even says in the notes, AE defined in section D3, right? That's back in chapter D in the tension chapter where it talks about AE is the shear lag factor times the net area. J4 point 2 is where it says elements in shear. And this we'll eventually talk about when we get to design of beams. But similarly, there's shear yielding and shear rupture. VRN for yielding is phi times 0.6 Fy AgV. Your phi is 1. There's this 0.6 factor, which we'll talk about when we do shear design itself. And then Fy is your yield stress. And AgV is your gross cross-sectional area in shear. All right, that's what that V tells you. Then we also have shear rupture, where phi RN is phi times 0.6 FU ANV. We don't have the shear lag issue, even though it's called shear, but right. And this time phi is similar to rupture and tension 0.75. That's our ultimate stress. Ultimate stress. That still looks terrible. And that's our net compared to tensile yielding, shear yielding has a phi of 1 instead of 0.9, and it has that 0.6 reduces the capacity. Other than that, it's still a yoke stress and still a gross cross-sectional area in shear. And then rupture, 0.75, similar to tensile rupture. Again, the 0.6 additional reduction, ultimate stress, and we use the net cross-sectional area instead of the effective because we don't have the shear lag issue that you have with a tensile force. Now, you put them together for block shear. This 0.6 FUANV, right, that is shear. Shear rupture. This is tensile rupture. This is shear yielding, and this is tensile rupture. So what this is telling you is your design strength for block shear is the lesser of two scenarios. One, in both scenarios, you fracture in your tensile plane. But in the first scenario, in only one scenario, you yield or you rupture in shear. So you'll always have tensile rupture. It's whether or not you have shear yielding or shear rupture. And because of that rupture in the tensile plane, you have a phi of 0.75, right? We're not messing around there. You'll also notice that you only have to look at the net the net tensile area, not the effective. You don't have to find a shear lag factor. Well, there is a shear. There is the shear lag factor. The shear lag factor is in this one. Sorry. There is a shear lag factor for block shear, and it is in the commentary. See figure C-J4.2. That means it's in the commentary. For section J4. That means that it is all the way back 16.1-445. No idea what page this would be. Sing in the alphabet here. Okay. We're still in K. J comes before K. Okay. There it is. Examples of when you have a shear lag factor of 1, and an example when you have a shear lag factor of 0.5. That's what it says. You either have a shear lag factor of 1 or a shear lag factor of 0.5. It says in tension, stress is uniform. It's talking about, you can see it's highlighting the tensile failure plane. The second scenario is So it looks like the uniform ones are when you mostly have a pure tension, right? Like a brace. This says beam, but that means that there's some type of tensile force in your beam. So if you have a beam and only one row of bolts, then it would be uniform. But if you have a beam with two rows of bolts, then you'll have some type of non-uniform tension. Because in this case, right, the tension is like, right, So if you're curious which one to use, generally for tension numbers, we're going to be using one, and you can come and look at the commentary and compare to your actual connection geometry for some more guidance. Block shear is a rupture or tearing phenomenon, not a yielding limit state, which is why we have tensile rupture. You could have shear yielding, but you might have shear rupture. Okay. That's what it says in the commentary. So. Says one for most tension numbers. So, oh, I meant to switch these. I'm gonna put this one up here first. Oops. Before we do the example, I wanna before I do the example, I want to summarize block shear limit state, checking it. How you go about checking block shear. First of all, identify all your possible block shear configurations. And that's what I don't know. I personally find that fun, like a little, visualization problem. Like, ooh, it could break this way, or it could break this way, right? And then for each configuration, calculate your gross section your gross section in shear, your net section in shear, and your net section in tension. Block shear design strength is the minimum of shear yielding and tensile rupture or shear rupture and tensile rupture. So what you can actually do is figure out which one's the lower, shear yielding or shear rupture, and then add that to your tensile rupture for your design strength. And then I guess after that, is the minimum for all your configurations, right? And sometimes it'll be obvious, like maybe they'll have the same shear area, but the tension will be bigger for one of the configurations, so choose the smaller one. You might not have to calculate all of them, or you could just, you know, for fun. So that is the procedure for checking block shear. So let's do an example. Here we have a grade 50 tension member connected with, it's an L 6 by 4 by 1/2, connected with 3 3/4 inch bolts. Determine the block shear rupture member, strength of the member. Right, so I guess this is assuming we have a, a tensile force that way. This only has one possible block shear, and that is this chunk right here. Tension plane and the shear plane. So one block shear configuration. So let's see, that's our step one, right? Step two. Calculate A and B, H E B, and A and T. Well, I'll switch the shears because it's gross is usually easier. But so let's see. A and V or A G B, that's the gross. And it goes to the center of that bolt hole. So AGV has a length of 10 inches, right? That's what that is. 10 inches. And a thickness, the cross-sectional thickness, is the thickness of the plate, which is 1/2 inch, right? The angle has a 6 inch leg, a 4 inch leg, and is 1/2 inch thick. So that's where I got that 1/2 inch gross sheer area is 5 square inches, right? I didn't even get out my calculator for it. Sheer, gross, or net sheer. Net sheer. So if I look at the shear plane, I have to subtract out 1, 2.5, right? Half bolt holes. So my ANV, I'm gonna write a little equation, right? Is my AGV minus number of bolt holes, right, similar to before, times the diameter of the bolt hole, plus that 1/16, do I have to add that 1/16? Yeah, 1/16. Yeah. Plus my 1/16 accounting for damage times the thickness of my angle. So this is 3/4 inch bolts. Right, number of bolt holes is 2.5 because I'm going from the edge. There's 1 bolt hole, 2 bolt holes, 1/2 bolt hole. My diameter of my bolt hole is a 3/4 inch bolt. Has a standard hole, right? Assuming a standard hole. Doesn't say it anywhere, but assuming a standard hole, 3/4 inch, my diameter is 13/16. So if I calculate my shear net area, I've got 5 inches squared. I guess I can say my thickness of my angle. It's 1/2 inch, just so that we're all on the same page. My gross cross-sectional area, 5 square inches, minus 2.5 bolt holes, times 13/16, plus 1/16, times 1/2 inch. My net shear area is 3.91, right? Now I need to calculate my net tension, right? My net tension is this distance, which if I go and look, it's 2.5 inches, right? This distance, 2.5 inches minus 1/2 bolt hole, because I'm going right to the middle. I'm doing net, so 1/2 bolt hole. But I still have the same size bolt holes. So 13/16 plus 1/16, and my thickness of my angle is 1/2 inch. Does everybody see where I got that 1/2 a bolt hole right? Because my 2.5 inches is going to the center of that bolt hole. That gives me a net tensile area of, oh. That length, yeah. I need to subtract the half bolt hole from the 2.5 inches and then multiply the whole thing by 1/2 inch. 1.03. All right, I subtracted, all right, I need to end up with inches squared. So I took this length and I subtracted half a bolt hole and then I multiplied that net width, right? That's essentially a net width by the thickness of the plate, which is 1/2 inch. So those are my, right, I have my net tension, my net shear, and my gross shear. I need to calculate design strength, and I have two scenarios, shear yielding and tensile rupture, or shear rupture. Let's see, shear yielding, my design equation phi times 0.6 FYAGV plus U block shear FUANT. And shear rupture is right, the only difference is that's not what I wanted to do. Alright, the only difference is yield stress and gross shear area or tensile stress and net shear area. Both of them phi is equal to 0.75. If I go back and look, I need to know what that U I should use. If I go back and look at the picture, we're in that one, right? We got a single line of bolts in an angle. And this is my tension right there. So I get to use sheer light factor of 1. So let's see. Shear yielding. I got 0.75 for my phi. 0.6. Fy is 50 KSI. Gross shear is 5 square inches. 1 times 65 for my Fu. And my net tensile strength or tensile area was what, 1.03? Kips, 162.7, and then shear rupture. Now I get to use that 65 psi. My net shear was 3.91. Again, 165. That looks terrible. 165. So, really, and if you just check, right, 0.6 times 50 times 5. All right, this right here is what? 150 kips. 0.6 times 65 times 3.91 is 152.5 kips. So my, my shear yielding controls just barely. So my answer is the block shear strength is 163 kips for this connection. Right. So that is an example of a block shear design.